Good evening, everybody, and welcome to the Mars stream, and happy holidays, everyone. You have picked one of the best possible kind of nights to be here at the Mars, in my opinion. This is where you get to see new work come into being right before your eyes, and thank you for being here and supporting that. I'm David Harada. I'm the Director of Artist Relations here at the Mars. We've got things going most nights here on the Mars stream. We're doing a short week here because of the holiday, but tomorrow night on Wednesday, our Solo Arts Heal series continues. We've got Kevin Spencer, a magician who's been using magic and sleight of hand as a therapeutic tool over the years with a lot of success. And so that's tomorrow. He'll be talking to host Gail Schickley tomorrow at 7:30. Then this weekend we've got our holiday show, the Crown Prince of Fools, Unique Durek, with his family show, Foolala Home for the Holidays. That's this Sunday at 2 p.m. streaming live on Zoom. And then we'll be back with a pretty full lineup the following week. Now this show will be available for replay on our YouTube channel. We've got dozens of shows there. If you're needing some solo theater over the weekend when we're not broadcasting live, check it out. But this show will be available for rebroadcast, for replay. So if you've got friends who you think would enjoy it and weren't here, let them know. But for tonight, live here in our Zoom room, we are celebrating the creation of new work, and I can think of no person to better introduce you to it than the man who makes it all possible, Mr. David Ford. Take it away, David.
Hi, welcome to the Marsh, or rather, welcome to my living room and the living rooms and other rooms of the performers you're going to see here tonight. And the work you're going to see here tonight is new work. Most of it did not exist maybe 3 months ago. So that's a little bit of a miracle, plucked out of these confusing times. People actually making some creative work, some of which actually is about our confusing times. I wanted to mention that we're going to leave a couple mics unmuted tonight so that the performers can benefit from a little auditory feedback. And without further ado, I want to introduce our first performer of the night, Annamarie MacLeod.
Hey, hi, hi. Okay, quarantine real talk, okay? My 4-year-old is naked all the time. I'm not gonna force her to wear clothes. I mean, I asked my pediatrician and she just said, you know, yeah, all little kids are naked these days. Just, you know, I'm seeing an increase of bug bites and abrasions, so be careful when she's outside. You know, my 7-year-old is slightly better. He's just pajamas 24/7, you know. The school even sent us an email about making sure all the kids were in clothes with their hair brushed for distance learning. And I thought that was nice, actually, you know, that the school is trying to tell us jokes.
Yeah.
My husband has grown this beard. Like, it's really, like, really impressive. Like, it's really impressive. Beard. I myself have done something a little different. Okay. I learned to sew as a child, you know, just doll clothes and trial and error, gentle advice from mom and dad and grandma and even my great grandma, my great grandma, whom I called Graham. Graham had an old house. I mean, it was old when she was a new bride in the 1930s on a farm in Illinois, surrounded by a sea of glossy green corn leaves. When Graham was a new bride, the crops were sown by hand, and every fall she and Gramps would slowly follow the wagon, wrenching each corn cob off its stalk and tossing it in the back. Upstairs in Graham's very old house, there was an attic. Not a proper attic on its own floor, but just a little walled off gable on the second floor. And you got into it through a little blue door. It was just the right size for me. All the grown-ups had to duck down. And when you unlatched it and opened the door and went inside and clicked on the bare bulb next to your head, you could see a long room with walls sloping down each side and a wide plank in the middle. I was always warned not to step off that plank because you'll fall right through the floor and land in the kitchen. But on each side were such wonderful things, soft hanging wardrobes of strange clothes, stacks of black and white photographs of people I'd never heard of, boxes of ancient toys, huge trunks with dome lids, and strange hand-sewn dresses inside them. It was warm in the attic, and it smelled sweet and dusty, like a treasure map. Way in the back, there was a metal trunk with a tight-fitting lid. That was important because the mice had free rein up in the attic, but the trunk's lid kept it safe from their scamperings. It was so big I could have hidden inside. One day Graham took me up there and opened the lid and she said, "You can use anything in this trunk. You know, anytime you like, you don't even need to ask." And the trunk was full of fabric. Just cut pieces, scraps, the ends of Gramps' pants that always needed to be hemmed, garments cut out but never finished, just all sizes and colors and shapes from different decades. And this will be a vest for my bear. And this will be a dress for my bunny. And this will be a knight's cape. And this will be a rug for my dollhouse. And I've never stopped sewing. And now, you know, all we have is time. So I'm sewing. And I have become obsessed.
Oh, my God.
Jane Austen clothes. I have read most of her novels, of course. And that is not impressive. She only finished 6. Anyway, Jane Austen was alive during the Georgian and Regency eras in England. Georgian, like King George from Hamilton, you know, and then Regency, because, you know, after King George was a little too woo, son, the regent, took over for about 10 years. And Jane died during that time, sooner than anyone would have expected, of something. Maybe Addison's disease? All they knew back then was it was incurable. And apparently so painful that she begged to die for days before she succumbed. If I were Jane Austen at this point in my life, I would have less than a year to live, and I wouldn't even know it yet. Anyway, I've made 5 dresses. This was the first, just a white kind of day dress. And then there's a little jacket, a sleeveless Spencer jacket. It's all lined in pink. It's all hand-done, super cute. Then, pardon me,
This one over here, this is an embroidered silk dinner dress, okay? That one right there. And then the one in the middle is actually a copy of a dress that's in the Victoria and Albert Museum in England. Anyway, oh, and I don't know if you can see this. Look, I've got more fabric of one dress, two dress, this is a hat. This is another dress, that's three. That's a Spencer jacket, and there's another dress, and there's more. It's a lot. Someday I assume that I'm going to feel the satisfaction of enough. But until then, I just keep sewing. You know, it's very soothing. You know, it's mindless, but practical. It's something to do while I watch the kids, which is also mindless, but practical. Oh, and I'm learning all sorts of new stitches. Look, okay, so this one, that's a running stitch. Everybody knows that, up and down and up and down. Okay, great. This one in the middle is a back stitch. Actually, that's a better side. You'll see it more clearly. Okay, that's a back stitch. That's like much stronger. Okay, that one is a running back stitch. That's the combination of the first two. Okay, this is a hem. That's a handkerchief hem. So pretty, so neat. This one is actually a felling stitch. This is like the inside of your clothes. You get the seam allowance and then you tuck it down and it's so neat. Anyway, and I've joined online communities to learn how to do this. I mean, there are men and women across the world who have spent years researching and practicing and teaching these like old-fashioned tailoring techniques that you will not learn at a weekend workshop at Joanne Fabrics. No. The secret, I mean, you know, then and now, is underwear. Because the dresses don't fit right if you don't wear the right underwear. Oh, have you ever wondered how to pee in this? Okay, so underwear, as we know it now, drawers, panties, knickers, bloomers, have not been invented yet. And your socks come up to about your knee, so you just go. But I am wearing a lot of other undergarments. I will show you. Okay. On our next model, this is going to be a fashion show. I'm so excited. On our next model, we see a red redding coat. This model of coat is distinguished from the police coat of the period as it only fastens to the waist. This particular model was fashioned after men's military fashion. Ladies' clothes have often taken a clue from the boys. Underneath, we have a printed cotton dress, a day dress. This printed cotton would have been gotten from India. And I got mine from India too, because they invented it. This dress is called a drop front dress because the front drops down. This allows the wearer to easily put it on or take it off by herself. This particular dress fastens with buttons, but it would have been just as common to use pins, which would have provided a custom fit every single day. Underneath is the chemisette. The chemisette is the small piece of fabric from the wearer's décolletage to the neckline. Not for modesty. It's because we white people who have not invented sunscreen yet. The chemisette was worn only during the daytime. Underneath is the petticoat. Many could have been worn due to the temperature or for fashion. This petticoat is sky blue. Petticoats were often different colors because the dresses of the era were so sheer that the colors would show through. Now we are down to the wearer's stays. That's as far as I'm going, so don't worry. Don't turn up. So, stays. That doesn't sound very appealing, does it? Stays. No, well, they were also called bodies, but that's not really sexy either. And sometimes they were called a pair of bodies, which is weird, but they're still called a pair of pants. So anyway, the French would call this a corset. Now we're getting somewhere. But corset, that word wasn't really used in England until the 1830s, right? Long after Jane has, you know, because right now, if you're alive, Jane Austen, the English are not traveling because of, you know, the French Revolution and the Napoleon. And no, the English are staying at home. We are staying safe. And we are using the good old Anglo-Saxon words for things. Stays, because things stayed. Or bodies, because it's on your, I don't know. But the French word corset, that comes from the French word corps, which means body. So it's the same thing. Anyway, I've got on my stays. Pardon me, Jane. Now, I know what you're thinking. This looks uncomfortable. But wait. Stays were fit to you. Like exactly to you, by you, or someone who knew you very well, as was all the rest of your clothes, right? I mean, bespoke was the norm. There was no fast fashion in 1806. And anyone who has had any tailoring done will tell you that it makes the clothes more flattering and more comfortable. Because let's be honest, bras dig in, right? Here, here, here. No, stays redistribute that pressure throughout your whole torso. You know, bras pinch, stays hug. If I just forego a bra, just Lululemon all the time, then every little bulge will show. The stays smooth. They say, we got this. We just gonna show Mr. Darcy the best. But this is a pretty serious work of engineering. This is three layers of linen, and then stiffen further, sometimes with wood. Could be strips of metal, reed, baleen, which is also called whalebone. And the engineering gets more serious the the older you get and the more assistance you'd like. Regency stays were laced up the back. They ask that another's hands put them on you. You know, we're a social species. We were never meant to be alone. There was always someone there to literally support you, whether it was your sister, your paid servant, even a colleague. Think of all the maids in their little shared rooms, lacing up each other in the pre-dawn darkness. And I'm comforted by this legacy of clan, even though, to be honest, I usually just put mine on by myself with the extravagance of my own full-length mirror. And why is this the line of absurdity and embarrassment that I can't even ask my husband to help me? He helped me birth two children. He was down there at the business end. I mean, but this feels silly, you know? I can't ask him to do this. I just, it feels like though, God, this is embarrassing. It feels like a need. You know, ever since March, I've been feeling that hunger inside. You know, everything at my fingertips on the internet, everything shipped straight to my door, but nowhere to go. Nothing to do. Do you feel that empty waiting space inside you too? I've been trying to fill it up, mostly with food. I've gained a lot of weight since March. But when I wear my stays, it's like wearing a weighted blanket. I think I'm like one of those cows that needs to be squeezed in order to feel calm. These days, I just long to be held. And in my dark imaginings, I wonder, without my stays, would I just diffuse into the ether? But I'm a little worried that the UPS guy thinks I'm in a cult. I mean, when I go out to sign for a package like this, no one wears long dresses these days, except the Mennonites or Amish, someone who has, because of their religion, frozen their technology 100 more years ago, and we wonder, frozen their values in politics too? I don't want my black UPS guy to think that of me. Or to assume that my husband is making me a la The Handmaid's Tale. No, this is feminism. This is me wearing what I want. But I wouldn't be wearing this if we were still going out in the world. Unless I was going to the Jane Austen Festival in Bath, England, the second week of every September. But we're not going out. No, we're not. I'm not. Because I'm a Democrat who understands science. And anyway, my American passport is useless. So in this time of isolation and quiet days that are very much like each other, I spend my days decorating hats and hoping to wear them someday at the Jane Austen Festival in Bath, England, the second weekend of every September. And I get it. I get, Jane, I get the waiting. And I get the hunger. And I get the claustrophobia and the impotence. I know life isn't a novel. I know that. And knowing that, this is embarrassing. I am too old for dress up. But if years of therapy has taught me anything, it's that you can know one thing and still feel another. And I do know I love costumes. I mean, you know, my favorite holiday? It's Halloween. It's a chance to like poke into my psyche and make fun of my deepest fears. And this year I went as, oh, what's this? Who's this? It's Hester Prynne from The Scarlet Letter. Who did you know? My costumes are differently revealing. So what am I afraid of? What is there to be afraid of in a Jane Austen novel? Was that the point? Am I safe? Or am I actually in a Bronte story? Am I about to go wandering off under the windy moors after a ghost? Halloween is ancient. It's my legacy from all the Celtic blood in my veins. All Hallows' Eve was a night of spirits, a night of bonfires that would both light the way for those in need and ward off evildoers. It was a chance to meet your shadow self, if only for a moment. And maybe there was relief in knowing that the next day, everything would go back to normal. So I do take off my costumes when I want. And I put them on when I want.
Remember the pins? So, I time travel just enough to enjoy it. The fashion, the music, the artwork, the dancing, the manners, the romance. But I dip out before I hit the legal status of women. The slave trade, the death rate. It's safe to say I have mixed feelings about all of this. Like the bonfires that both guide old friends back from purgatory while repelling malevolent spirits. How do you tell two ghosts apart? I keep a light on, a light of creativity. Of curiosity, a light of silliness and celebration in the face of all that's happening. The legal status of women, the treatment of black and brown bodies, the death rate. And I hope my light is enough to guide love to me. A new circle of friends online. And maybe even the spirit of Graham come back for a night so I could say, if I loved you less, I might be able to talk about it more. But I haven't forgotten your strong hands threading my needle. When I went away for college, there was hardly anything left inside that chunk of fabric. But whenever I'd visit, I would go back to it, hoping that something new would have materialized inside. And sometimes I would find something, something I'd never really seen before, something new, something just right. But most of the time, it was just diminishing scraps of fabric. Graham died while I was away at college. And now, after decades of neglect, her very old house and everything in it has collapsed in on itself and is just waiting to be carried away by the truckful to the dump. But that trunk is still full inside my heart. That's my connection to her. That's my legacy from the unknown women who came before, adding their pieces, carefully, never knowing all the time. It was always waiting for me. It's the possibility that we can take our inheritance and remake ourselves. And it's the possibility that each time you take the time to open, you could find something, something you'd never really seen before. Something new, something just right. And that's why we still read novels that are 200 years old.
Hey!
Take that, Jane. Woo!
Yay!
So the piece you're about to watch is based on a true story. And while it is about facts, it is not a work of journalism. It's a work of art. And it is about the truth that exists beside the facts. After the 2016 election, us journalists were in a state of shock. Suddenly, those emails from Dad and Aunt Betty about, you know, how Muslim nurses don't wash their hands or how the Clintons killed their enemies were not funny. They were frightening. I get an assignment to cover Facebook groups that have been infiltrated by Russian agents spreading misinformation. And of course, I want to talk to some of the people in these groups. So I'm messaging with this woman, at least I think she's a woman on the internet, you can't always tell. And I say, are you aware that this Facebook group has been infiltrated by Russians, according to officials? And she writes back, LMFAO, laughing my fucking ass off. And she calls me a tool of the MSM. That's right-wing media talk for mainstream media. She's nasty and spiteful, and I am polite. You remember polite. I knew it wouldn't mean anything to this woman, but, you know, I have to keep up a sense of being a professional journalist. Later on, I start to think about certain Russian novels. I was a Russian cultural history major in college, and my favorite Russian novelist is Fyodor Dostoevsky. And I'm thinking about Crime and Punishment. This is perhaps one of his shortest novels, but it's still a very important one. Okay, it's only got 3 out of 4 stars on Goodreads. So much for classics. It begins, Ya chelovek bolnoy, ya zloy chelovek, ya dumayu shto imenya bolit pachen. I am a sick man. I am a spiteful man. I think there is something wrong with my liver. The main character is a retired middling civil servant who lives in a basement apartment in St. Petersburg by himself. He is nasty, petty, and he's self-destructive. He says, still, if I do not call a doctor, it is from spite. If my liver is bad, let it get worse. Lately, I feel like the internet is filled with these dark creatures sprouting up like poisonous weeds. And oh, how ironic when they discover that the trolls are coming from an office in St. Petersburg. I get an assignment to go find one of these dark creatures. My editor wants me to find out who wrote a particular fake news story. Here it is. FBI agent suspected in Hillary email leaks found dead in apparent murder-suicide. It's in a publication called the Denver Guardian. I mean, this article is amazing. It's got this convoluted story plot about how an FBI agent investigating Hillary Clinton's emails dies under very mysterious circumstances. And look at this picture. The house is ablaze. You see the silhouettes of the firemen, and you've got the weather and the local news. You can even get your horoscope. This article was seen by over 500,000 people on Facebook alone. The only thing is, there is no Denver Guardian. There is no FBI agent, no murder-suicide. This photo is a stock photo. Somebody has put a lot of time into this. When I set out on this journey to find who wrote it, I don't know if I'm going to end up in St. Petersburg or St. Louis. I need some help. I need someone who can scrape the bowels of the internet for sewage. Somebody who really understands the workings of the dark web. I need a nerd. Joan Jensen here. A friend puts me in touch with a very nice geek to assist. Yeah, I think I can help. John is a lovely guy from New Zealand and a very smart software engineer. He loves a good mystery, especially when it involves catching creeps. So, John, I'm wondering if you think you can help me figure out who owns this website. I'll give it a try, Mike. 2 days later, he calls me back. So, I think I got something for you. Yes? So whoever did this was pretty clever, but he messed up. He used WordPress and he left a handle on the original documents at Let Texas Secede. Let Texas Secede? Is he like a right winger who wants to break up the union? Maybe he's a Russian who's pretending to be a right winger, but still wants to break up the union? Dunno, but it appears that he also had connections to other websites, and I went out tracing them and discovered that they're all connected to a single Amazon server. And let me read some of them off for you. We've got nationalreport.net, WashingtonPost.com.co, conservativefrontline.com. I could go on. There's about 25 of them in all. Whoa, it's like a fake news empire. Yeah, and guess what? That led me to a site that had an old email address, and I'm loving this. That led me to a name. A Justin Kohler seems to be behind a lot of this. Justin Kohler? That can't be real. I mean, jest, as in, this is in jest, just a joke. Dunno, mate. But his initials are also JC, as in Jesus Christ. And Jesus seems to have a LinkedIn page. It says he once sold magazine subscriptions, worked as a database administrator and a freelance writer, and apparently he's a contributor to World Boating Magazine. Don't blame anyone for sailing, that's okay. So is Hillary being tormented by a cabal of international yachtsmen? Maybe he's a rich Republican. Dunno. I call the research library and they discover there is indeed someone named Justin Kohler, and he's married to an attorney and he lives along the coast just an hour outside of LA. The next day, I hop on a plane to Los Angeles. Ah. I go to pick up my producer, Luke. Okay. He's an intern, but this is public radio and that's all we got right now. At least he is tall and male. Okay, Luke, get 2 bottles of water and what equipment are you bringing? I've got shotgun microphone and mic cord, recorder. Great, and do you have headphones? Yeah. Great. Okay. I'll drive and, you navigate. So it should be, over here. In a strip mall? It should be that storefront right there. Mailbox Inc. P.O. Box, UPS. Ugh. I don't know why, but I guess I was just hoping there'd be like an office door with Disinfomedia Inc. across the front. Really? Not. Well, we have his home address and it's just around the corner. Do you think we should go? My friend, we must. We've already come this far. Okay. Keep the recorder rolling, and I'm going to describe as we move along. So it appears that Justin Kohler lives in a nice upper middle class neighborhood with two-car garages and manicured lawns. And Mr. Kohler's house is a sprawling ranch with a big front lawn and a palm tree out front, because hey, this is Southern California. A big American flag, because I guess he's a patriot. Okay, are you ready? Yeah. Don't worry, it's gonna be fine. I need to assure the intern, and frankly, I could use a little assurance. Do you think he would mistake the shotgun mic for a shotgun? Maybe he's got a shotgun? Oh my God, I hear a dog barking. The dog's bark is a little too high pitched to be scary. Hi, I'm looking for Justin Kohler.
Okay.
Wanted to ask him something.
Okay.
I have this article here, and I'm wondering if you wrote it.
No.
You didn't write this.
No.
I'm from public radio, and you know, we have been doing some tracing on the internet, and we discovered that your company, Disinfo Media Inc., had many websites, National Report.
Don't know what to tell you.
Nothing. If you think of anything, here's my card.
Have a nice day.
Thank you so much for your time. Do you think that was him? Oh, it was definitely him. Wow, whoever he is, he's doing okay. I mean, nice house, new carpets, nice furniture. And he didn't look anything like what I expected. I mean, kind of like middle-aged dad. You're sure that was him? I'm sure. Luke and I drive back to LA, and about an hour later, we pull up to a bar for a well-deserved drink with some friends. And, you know, I check my email, and there's a note. Hi. I'm sorry I was so rude, but you took me by surprise. I'm actually a big public radio fan. You may not realize it yet, but we're on the same side. I can explain. And he gives me his number, and he tells me to call him the next day. Hi, Miller.
You know, you could have just called instead of just showing up.
I figured you'd just hang up on me.
Perhaps.
So is Disinfo Media your company?
Yeah, but I didn't write that article.
Well, I'd love to hear more about who did, but before we go any further, I'm wondering if you'd be willing to do a recorded interview with me.
I don't know.
Now, I have been here before, the reluctant interviewee. And I have got to get this guy to talk. In real life, I am not a hard ass at all. But I have this other persona, my reporter persona. She's tough, she knows what she wants, and she's willing to do what it takes. She doesn't mind putting a little fear into someone as part of the job to get at the truth. Now, I start gentle and soft. Watch. So, Mr. Kohler, you said you were a fan of public radio. This is your chance to get on our air and tell your story.
Yeah, I don't know.
I'm actually starting to feel like I'm a character in Crime and Punishment, the detective, Porfiry Petrovich, whose slow, persistent questioning of the main character, Raskolnikov, leads to a murder confession.
You know, I don't mind talking to you, but about being recorded. Can't you just take notes?
Mr. Kohler, public radio fan, you know how boring stories are when they don't have any interview tape.
Yeah, I just...
Okay, I have circled the drain long enough. Mr. Kohler, we're going to do this story no matter what you decide to do. We know who you are, we know what you've done, and we're gonna put your name on the air. So this is your opportunity to tell your side of the story.
Can I think about it?
Of course. The next day, I get a note. He's going to do it. Yes. Instead of traveling back to LA, I send my producer Luke to his house to record his side, and I'm in the studio recording my side. Hi there, Mr. Kohler. Thanks for doing this. Is Luke there, and has he started the recorder?
Yeah.
Great. Let's get a little voice level on you so Luke can make any adjustments. Describe what shoes you're wearing.
Oh, I'm wearing a pair of black Nikes with white soles and, you know, one of those white Nike stripes up the side.
Great. And if you would just state your name and title for the record.
Oh, I'm Justin Kohler, and I am the founder and CEO of Disinfo Media, Inc.
He sounds a little nervous, so I throw him a few softball questions just to warm him up. Mr. Kohler, do you own a yacht?
A yacht? No. Why?
Well, I noticed your LinkedIn page says you wrote for a boating magazine.
Oh, yeah, I did. I, you know, I don't really know anything about yachts now, but they hired me as a travel writer, and the pay was really good. So, you know, but I don't care for yachts.
So tell me, how long have you been running Disinfo Media?
Oh, since late 2012, 2013, I was doing research on what's now being called the alt-right, you know, and Disinfo Media was kind of a response to that.
Wait a minute, really?
Yeah, well, you know, I was a poli-sci major in college, and I was always fascinated with propaganda and how it worked. And with the internet, you know, I got really interested in how things go viral. And the idea was to infiltrate the echo chamber of the alt-right with blatantly false and fictional stories, and then call them out as what they were to show how crazy the alt-right actually is.
Wait a minute, you're not a conservative.
Oh, no, I'm a registered Democrat and proud of it.
So what, why are you doing this?
To show how crazy the alt-right is.
Okay, I'm actually starting to feel like I haven't found the underground man, I found Raskolnikov. Here's the elevator pitch for Crime and Punishment. the main character, Raskolnikov, kills an old pawnbroker to show he can commit the perfect crime to show how smart he is. But his subconscious slash conscience, he makes a mistake because of it, and he confesses. Now, my Raskolnikov, also known as Justin Kohler, didn't kill anyone. He just put a knife right through the heart of the truth to show how smart he is. And perhaps he made a mistake because he has a conscience, and that will lead to a confession. Mr. Kohler, when were you going to come clean about your fake news enterprise? Oh, I've spoken out. You have? My first site, it's National Report. It's still my favorite. Anyway, it had an email link, and I'd get messages from the Washington Post, Vice, BuzzFeed. I talked to them. I told them my name was Alan Montgomery. You can look it up. Oh yeah. So why was National Report your favorite site?
It was really a spoof site. It wasn't even meant to be fake news. Unfortunately, Facebook didn't see it that way, and they blocked it, and the readership and the advertising rates went down, and I couldn't pay my writers. I was kind of pissed, because it seemed to me it was pretty obvious that it was a spoof site. But
it is still up.
Oh yeah, we made it even spoofier, and I really love to write the headlines.
Let me see. Oh, Chris Christie nominated to National Food Court. Not bad. What about the Denver Guardian?
Oh, that was our way of trying to get around the censors. It was what we thought was going to be the next phase of fake news.
We?
I have a whole group of writers who work for me, and the idea was to make a page that looked like it was a real local news site, and, to put weather and sports and that kind of stuff, and that way you could avoid the censors.
So, did you write the article about the FBI agent and the murder-suicide?
No.
Can you tell me who did?
I'm not going to tell you. And besides, I don't really know. We use pen names, but that was a good one. I mean, total red meat for the alt-right. If you go online, you will find probably tens of thousands of these stories about how the Clintons kill their enemies. And this just fed right into that. And Snopes, the Denver Post, the regular media, they debunked it. But these people don't believe them. So it didn't matter.
So I have to ask you, how much money do you make from these sites?
Oh, I prefer not to say.
Come on, Mr. Kohler. How about just a ballpark figure?
I don't know. Between $10,000 and $30,000 a month, depending on the month. But it wasn't about the money. I was just trying to show people that you gotta smarten up about what's on the internet. Facebook, Google, the government, they're not gonna do anything about this.
For a moment, I thought, what am I doing in real news? It takes so much more work. You have to find sources and you have to check facts. I wanted to say to him, oh, how convenient that you made more money doing fake news than I made doing the real stuff. But I didn't. You know, I need to keep up the front of a professional journalist. So, do you ever feel guilty, since you say you're a Democrat, that you played a role in Hillary Clinton's defeat? Oh, no. I mean, as much as I like Hillary, she was a poor candidate. She came with a lot of baggage. And, you know, Trump was smart. He understood his base, he knew what they wanted to hear. We played with that. There are a lot of reasons that Hillary Clinton lost that election. You guys, the mainstream media, you gave Trump like $2 billion of free advertising by writing down everything he said and did. No, I'm not guilty. I'm not gonna hold that on my conscience. Maybe I would have done things differently about the Denver Guardian. I don't know. But people have got to wake up. And I was just trying to get them to wake up.
Because you're smarter? Because you made money taking advantage of vulnerable people? That's what I wanted to say, but I didn't. So, Mr. Kohler, do you think you will continue to write fake news?
You know, I've been giving that some thought lately, and I think maybe I've dabbled long enough. You know, I've got a wonderful marriage, wonderful kids, a beautiful home. I think maybe it's time to do something else.
Justin Kohler seemed to stay true to his word, and he ended his entire fake news empire. I saw him one more time at a conference in Austin, Texas. And you never believe this, but a group of news organizations and foundations invited him to speak about fake news. He told me that he had paid his own way, paid for his hotel room, and, you know, he genuinely seemed to feel bad about what he had done. Raskolnikov, well, you know, he confessed, went to prison, became a Christian, repented. Unfortunately, the pawnbroker stayed very dead, and Hillary Clinton lost the 2016 election. It seems that fake news definitely played some role in that. And every day I look around and the truth just keeps getting stabbed. One of these days, I worry it's just gonna die. All of this started to make me think about evil, what it looks like, how it's justified. In fiction, we have characters like Darth Vader with his booming voice, his black cape and lack of tenderness, the unquenchable lust for power. In real life, we have Hitler and his henchmen. Hitler was probably the last time we could all agree that a particular leader was truly evil. But in the trials that followed the war, his henchmen turned out to be rather ordinary. The famous philosopher, Hannah Arendt, coined the term, the banality of evil, after covering the trial of Adolf Eichmann, the Nazi who oversaw the deportation of the Jews to the death camps. Her verdict on his character was that he was just a bureaucrat trying to climb the Nazi career ladder. Now, I'm not calling anyone a Nazi. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just thinking about evil, how it happens, how it's justified. Who is Justin Kohler? An ordinary guy. He cares about his family, his wife, his kids. There he is, taking his kids to school, walking his dog, writing about yachts. An ordinary guy running a fake news empire out of his house.
for fun, out of spite. A Raskolnikov, committing murder to prove just how smart he is. Oh yeah, I'm gonna show you right-wingers how smart I am and how dumb you are. Oh yeah, and you know what? He just made a lot of people a little dumber.
Yay. Yay. Yay.
So, thanks for the breadsticks and the wine. Hippa pippa, dibbly do. What's next? Chica, you're a newcomer. What brought you here today? I was dumped.
Who dumped you? Who broke up with you?
Mike's girlfriend, HR. I broke up with HR once. Trina, just so you know, this support group may be loosely based on other support groups, but start at the beginning. Okay, well, let's see. HR. I broke up with HR. No, my ex-girlfriend, HR. She ended our relationship. So, but 7 years ago, a mutual friend set us up. Yeah. And we met at Four Barrel Coffee in the Mission on a Tuesday. I was sitting in the window and she pulls up. I go outside to greet her and she hugs me. Hi, I'm Trina, right? I'm HR. I hear you like coffee. Double shot extra foam coconut milk latte? Got it. We trade Dyke March stories of the 90s.
Oh.
Okay. 1993. Oh God, I look weird. Oh, big hoop earrings, dark lipstick, muy linda. What's your sticker say? Butches do it better. Lucky guy. Let's see yours. Okay, okay. '94. You were in Dykes on Bikes. That's great. Look at your bike. What is your what's your t-shirt say? I like fucking girls. For the next 2 weeks, she courts me. Two lattes, three walks through Dolores Park, four hugs, short hugs, many texts, a surprise delivery for dinner, endless laughs. But I wasn't gonna let her kiss me yet. Until the Friday afternoon, we're finishing our espresso. So what are you doing after this? Why? And pulls out an extra motorcycle helmet. You'll see. I remember what her waist felt like. Ready? Yep. And we drive up Knob Hill to Potrero Heights, down to the Presidio Green and above the bay. We get out. She leans against her bike. We stand looking at the bay. You know why I like this view? Why? Measuring our fingers, because you're here, and pulls me into a kiss. I hang on for dear life as we go across the Bay Bridge and then dive into her bed for a weekend sexathon. The first night, her cats join us. pushing me immediately to the opposite end of the bed. The first one, a little persnickety, there, warms my feet, while the other one takes a path the size of the bed and resembles a feral raccoon. But who cares? Oh my gosh, Rodriguez, you have the fattest rom-com movie collection from the 80s. Yeah, I know, but you should see my record collection. Okay, how about we have a midnight movie hour? I'll make us popcorn. Great, lots of butter and sea salt. Let's watch Valley Girl and pause and recreate the scenes. Yeah, okay, but none of this like whitewash crap here. Nope, just totally queer and trans people of color talent.
Okay, time out here. So was Dirty Dancing and St. Elmo's Fire rom-coms?
The Outsiders were not, but toss Ponyboy over here anytime. There needs to be a remake of Karate Kid from the 80s, but the lead should be an Afro-Cuban, multilingual, pansexual, non-binary hero. Friends, hi, newcomer. Back to my story. So, H.R. Rodriguez, did you have a girlfriend in high school? Yeah, I had a few. I was the first butch to take a femme to the senior prom. Oh my God, that's amazing. I wish I had gone to the prom with a hot butch. Let's have a do-over. A gay prom? No, but my sister's getting married this weekend. Really? Yeah, you can be my plus one. I'll think about it. She calls me every night at 8 o'clock sharp. So, Linda. Yes, Rodriguez. If a studly butch took you to the prom, would you prefer if she wore an elegant Frank Sinatra blue suit or a nerdy punk silver and gray red retro one? Nerdy punk silver gray retro one. Yes, great. Calls the next night. If you had sexy pumps delivered in 2 days, would you prefer a double strap platform? Okay, and size 7. Holiday hot red or midnight blue? Holiday hot red. And 4 inches 6. She calls the next night. So would you prefer tacos de pollo, ceviche, or red pasta? Tacos de pollo. Done. The night before the wedding, she calls me. Hello, Trina. Would you like to be my date for my sister's wedding? Yes, HR Rodriguez, I'd love to. The next day, she pulls up in a rented convertible and hops out with a small box. May I pin this corsage on you? Yes, you may. My sister approves. It's a big day after all. We sit during the service holding hands. And at the reception, she makes an announcement. Mira, okay, everybody, all right. Listen up, Primo, Uncle Mike. I will cock block any of you who disrupt our funky chicken dance or try to electric slide between me and my girl. Oh, so now I'm your girl. I'm making a point. They need to be respectful. Your mom was calling you Helena Marina. Oh, I hate that name, but love my mother. She's sweet. She's a handful, but she did wink at me at the altar. During the service? See, Wapa, she approves. Big band music plays. HR takes my hand and guides me into the crowds, and we move to Hector Lavoe, Mark Anthony, Celia Cruz, Selena. Bitty, bitty, bum, bum. Bitty, 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 bum, bum. This needs to be in the movie. Definitely. Hey, I want to take you somewhere. Okay. She grabs her jacket and we run across the lawn to a canopy of trees as rain starts coming down. Trina Marina. Yes, HR Rodriguez. Si eres mi novia. Yes, I will be your girlfriend. And we're spinning and dancing and kissing, and HR covers me with her jacket as we lean against a tree. HR, I have something to tell you. I'm totally falling in love with you and I'm soaked. She She kisses me. Trina, Trina, I have something to tell you too. I have sap on my hands. I'm falling in love with you and I'm sappy. That weekend was like our honeymoon. Spending hours going back to what were you doing in 1981, 72, 95, and recast my rom-com movie. So, when did you know? Well, since I was little, pretty much had queer tattooed on my sleeve. I was always called a tomboy, you know? Played soccer and basketball, pretended I was in a ska band on my skateboard. Avoided skinheads most of the time. Oh, God, sorry. I played field hockey and lacrosse. Were you a prepster? No, I went to an arts high school and I sang in the chorus and did plays and wrote poetry and lip-synced to music videos. Okay. What's your rom-com story? Well, when I was 14, a freshman, this kid we called Sid Vicious started harassing me with his friends. Trina's a poser, poser. Trina, hey, spick, greaseball. Trina's a fucking Puerto Rican. You're such a fucking poser. I'm sorry, can we go back in time so I can kick this guy's ass? Totally. So this racist motherfucker, Sid Vicious, like from the Sex Pistols, it's just a nickname. So what happened next? So one day out of nowhere, he starts kicking me with his combat boots and I kick him back and he cuts me with a dull knife from the dining hall. Please tell me somebody kicked his ass. I have no idea, but I block it out. And then years later, I'm 18 and I'm a senior and the 16-year-old sophomore catches my eye, Megan. She's like a cross between an androgynous beat poet vampire and the artful dodger. And after 2 weeks of courting, I'm walking back from the fields and I go to her dormitory where she lives. Hi. Hey. She turns down her music and embraces me. I smell frankincense and I hear da-da-da, 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 da-da. Did I? That's so cool. What is that? Cocteau twins? And like an acrobat, her hand moves through my hair. What was that? I join her on her bed and she touches my dress. Oh, I like this. Suddenly, Megan's roommate, Pink Fuzzy, walks in. Shit. This is so missing with my plan to have my first girl kiss. Casually stroke Megan's arm, and Pink Fuzzy is scribbling in a notebook and taking out a purple marker. Mom is coming power. We curl up under the covers, and Megan strokes my hair and my face, and Pink Fuzzy did not just get out a sketch pad. I kiss her temple and her cheek. And just like that, Pink Fuzzy exits. That took long enough. Megan starts to suck on my finger. Oh my God, I'm having lesbian sex. She puts her mouth near mine and I close my eyes. This is the longest I've ever waited. Is it happening? Is it happening now? And she puts her lips near mine and I feel her tongue and her kiss, and we're kissing, and I'm kissing her back, and Pink Fuzzy exits and enters again. Shoot, it's 3:55, I gotta go. Yeah, see you tomorrow. So the next day in the smoking pit, Megan and I are sitting together, she's smoking, and Sonic Youth starts coming towards us. I see Sid look right at Megan and nod. Apparently, Sid has the biggest crush on me. Well, do you like him? Oh my God, are you kidding me? He's such a fucking poser. You look really good today. Thanks. Want to go back to my dorm? Oh my God, Trina, that's it. That's the perfect story. It is? Yeah, that's it. We see them at the prom having a lesbian kiss at the end. Last scene of the movie in front of the entire school. That's it. I was so infatuated with HR's reaction. I knew I would love her for the rest of my life. And unlike Tony and Maria in West Side Story, neither of us were struck by bullets. But I could have died in her arms right there. I keep wanting her to call me, but she doesn't want to communicate, so that's why I'm here. Trina, you're in the right place. Chica, just so you know, they never return.
We've been there before, Trina.
Thanks. I wish that helped. Breadstick? Thanks. Chardonnay? Definitely. Thank you. It stings, but it's better than being alone. Salud.
Yay. Yay.
So, you know what? Let's play a game. Let's play Never Have I Ever. Okay, I am gonna make some statements about myself. And they're things I've never done. And if you have done those things, I want you to take a shot or a gulp or a sip or whatever you got. Okay, you ready? All right, first one. Never have I ever jumped out of an airplane. Anyone? Yeah. Oh, all right. One risk taker. Great. Next one. Never have I ever been arrested. Anyone out there? Martians? Arrested for protests? It counts. All right, maybe more of you will have this one. Never have I ever watched a Marvel movie. Oh, wait, no, that's not true. I did go to see Iron Man, but I fell asleep, so I don't think that counts. I'm more of a quirky rom-com kind of gal myself. I never really understood action adventure movies. I'm sure they're fun and exciting, and good versus evil is always a very exciting storyline. I just think it's really hard to watch those super people movies when you are a super person. What do they call those people? The Marvel people, that one franchise calls them mutants. I find that a bit unflattering. Superhero, that's it. Superhero, like the sandwich. When I was in high school, we used to have this drinking game where we would confess our secret superpower wish. Like some kids wish they could fly, or other kids wanted a car with all the gadgets like Batman. Mikey, one of our friends, always wanted to spew fire. Mikey's now in prison. Yeah. My own super secret superpower wish was that I wish I could rewind time 2 minutes Because that is the time you realize you could have done something different than you did, something not so mean or angry. You know, it's just like it's not really a superpower. It's like an espresso shot power, not like a venti latte power. Continue with that metaphor. You know, it will just let me quickly rewind time, fix something, and move on. Now, I didn't tell my friends in high school this because I hadn't really grown into it, but I really have a superpower, like a Trente power. And if you promise, I mean promise, swear on a stack of your sacred text of choice that you will never, ever, ever tell anyone, I'll tell you what it is. I can become invisible. Well, not right now, of course. I mean, I'm on a Zoom call and there's lights and you're all looking at me, but really is a very impressive power. I mean, I can be standing in Starbucks, holding my phone, getting ready to order and pay, and suddenly, seemingly out of nowhere, someone, usually a middle-aged white guy, will jump in front of me and place his order. Like he didn't even see me. Because he didn't. Because I'm invisible. Before the lockdown, I used to do this all the time at fancy bars and restaurants. The bigger, the better. I could stand or sit and watch an entire game of baseball on the TV behind the bar, maybe even a doubleheader if I wanted to. And if I'm not careful, the invisibility could slip. I have to be very vigilant. It might slip, and then a nice lady or some older gentleman will suggest to the bartender that maybe they want to take my order. Now, by far the best place to use this superpower is on a Southwest Airlines flight. The key is you got to buy that $25 upgrade so you can get in with the A's, you know, the special group, the super group, the group that takes up all the aisle seats. And then here's the difficult part of the transformation. I sit in my aisle seat and I do not make eye contact with the B's, C's, or D's. And I put down my tray table so it rests on my belly. And suddenly the entire row disappears. Now, occasionally a grandma will be standing next to my invisible chair and she's looking around the entire airplane for a seat. Grandmas are my weakness. They're like my kryptonite. And I'll catch her eye and reveal the entire row. And next I know, Gladys is sitting next to me chatting the entire way back to San Francisco. There seems to be a glitch in the system when it comes to older men and older women. They can pierce my invisibility. I'm gonna have to look into that. Maybe there's an online superpower manual that can have a bug fix or a system upgrade or something. Oh, hey, or maybe it's them. Maybe it's their cataract surgery. Who knows? Now, during this superpower confession, some of you might be saying to yourself, Laura Jane, it sounds like you're just being ignored, not invisible. Oh, au contraire, mon frère. I have been time after time invisible and then reveal myself to the bartender or the line jumper at Starbucks with a, hey, I'm right here. And without fail, they say, oh, I didn't see you there. So yeah. Clearly, the invisibility works. I mean, I am not a delicate, dainty flower. So it's science, folks. Before
I discovered this superpower. It was kind of like in my late 20s, early 30s. And before that, it felt like sometimes there was an actual spotlight on me. I developed very early, like at 11, much earlier than all my friends. And suddenly boys in class were paying attention to me. And then a few years later, teenage boys and men started to look at me. Made me very uncomfortable at first and second and third. My brother's friends started to look at me too and talk to me. Suddenly, I wasn't just the bratty little sister. Suddenly, I was a girl with big blonde hair and big boobs and a big record collection that she'd stolen from her brother. I mean, it was kind of cool, right? They'd been ignoring me for years and suddenly I'm getting all this attention. I just wish there would have been somebody there to teach me how to handle it. Laura Jane, that guy is totally looking at you. Laura M. is pointing at the porter helping people with luggage. We're on our first train trip from Chicago to San Antonio for a Lutheran Christian group rally. Oh, I'll help you with that, miss, said the porter with a tobacco-stained beard. He took my plastic Samsonite luggage and held it over his head, making a big show of it, like it's a Louis Vuitton trunk. Thank you. He was standing a little too close to me, and his smile was a little too bright. The spotlight was on me. That guy was totally looking at your boobs, Laura M. says as we walk down the aisle to find our seats, like it was my fault. But I don't say anything. Laura M. is the coolest girl around. Yes, folks, even Christian youth groups have a hierarchy. And Laura M. was at the top. And we were going to be besties. The success of my first overnight chaperone trip lay in her hands. She was the most popular at school. We went to the same school. We went to the same church. Our parents worked at the same place. We took ballet classes together. I mean, my God, our first names are the same. Of course, we're going to be besties. And Laura wasn't really a mean girl. You know, she was just very, very popular. As we're sitting in our seats, she says to me, I'm going to go take a walk. I'm bored. And she looks down at me like, are you coming with me? I pop up, hell yes, I'm coming with her. This is where we're going to become besties. We're going to gossip and talk about boys and makeup. And we walk down the aisle to the front of the train car where all the boys from our group are, Eric and Carl and Michael F. and the porter. He's passing out blankets to everybody. He sees me and he hands me a blanket and he says loud enough for everyone in the car to hear, here you go, Dolly. And he looks at my boobs. All the boys in our group start to giggle and Laura M. is giggling. So I start to giggle because that's what a girl does when other people are giggling, she giggles. I didn't really understand why they thought it was funny. Oh, and then it hit me. Dolly Parton. Of course, God, she was so popular at that time. Don't cry, don't cry, don't you dare cry. I scold myself, and I don't. I keep that all inside. The burning in my eyes and my throat, I keep it down. I shut everything down to stay safe. I am literally standing behind Laura M., clutching my blanket. I disappear into a silent blob. God, you didn't say anything when we were there. You didn't say anything to anybody. Laura M. spends the rest of the trip talking to one of the older girls. Carol McCowan. I remain that silent blob for the rest of the trip, the whole week, choosing to spend most of my downtime with the adult chaperones. One of the parents teaches me how to needlepoint. And while that's not really a marketable skill in the world of a teenage girl, it did prove to me that I can stab something 1,000 times. I love Dolly Parton. When I was a kid, I had a bunch of her 45s. Jolene, Here You Come Again, Islands in the Stream. I played them all the time, but I never had made a personal connection between me and Dolly Parton. Honey, all you got to do is stand up straight and stick them out. Let them get a good look at you. Oh, Dolly, I can't do that. For one thing, I'm a kid. They'll all laugh at me. That's right, honey. That's what you want. You want to get them on your side. Tell them a joke. I was the first woman to burn my bra. Took the fire department 4 days to put it out. You can have that one. First one's free. Oh, thank you, Dolly. But I don't think it's going to work. I mean, for one, I'm not a glamorous country and western superstar. Okay, honey, you're not ready. I understand. You just call me when you are. I'll just be two doors down, laughing and drinking and having a party. Isn't Dolly the best? She always knows the right thing to say or sing. I hadn't learned that yet. I hadn't really fallen in love with that bright, hot spotlight yet. Hey, we're going to Panama Reds for lunch. You want to come with us? Mr. Bush was standing next to my mom's desk with some salesman. Oh, no, Bill, I can't. I have to get these statements out. Well, your loss. 2-for-1 margaritas. What about you, Junior? I was standing at the copy machine wearing the dress my mother bought me from Carson Perry Scott. She wanted me to look professional while I assisted her that summer. She'd nixed my first summer job idea of walking beans. Now, walking beans was a coveted job in my neighborhood. Basically, you just wake up at dawn and then you weed a 1,000-acre soybean farm until the temperature gets humane. And then you go to the swimming pool to cool off and eat frozen Snicker bars. Heaven, right? My mom wanted me to learn a skill. And she didn't want me in the company of dangerous 15-year-old farm boys and lifeguards. So there I was, standing by the copy machine in my dress, which, if I'm honest, is a little tight. There was a gap right there. I look over to my mom to see what to do, and she doesn't say anything. She wants me to stay here and help her get those statements out, right? Or am I supposed to go? She wouldn't want me to go to lunch without her. I didn't know what to do, so I just waited. Then finally, oh, I don't care, just go. She didn't even look at me. Great, let's take Mike's car. And suddenly I was off to lunch with 2 grown-ass men drinking my first margarita. Pitcher of margaritas, 3 glasses. The waitress didn't even give us a second look. I was 15. There was no way I looked legal to drink in the state of Illinois. You like working at the paper company? Mm-hmm. You got a boyfriend?
No.
Can you drive yet?
Nope.
Punch some music in. He hands me $1 for the jukebox. Thank God. Anything to get away from that cologne and smoke. I spent a little too long making my selections. I start to get nervous. I look back at the men at the table, hoping to find them deep in conversation. But instead, I find I punch C5 on the jukebox and I walk back to the table as Dolly sings 9 to 5.
Yay. 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 Thank you all very much for coming to the march tonight, and thank you to the performers. And be sure and check out our website and all the other great shows that are happening here close to 7 days a week. So check it out. Thank you very much.